Okay, if you'll turn in your Bible to Proverbs chapter 12. This morning I'm going to give you several scriptures. And each of those scriptures are going to be put up on the screen. But if you want to keep up with them all, there's going to probably be more than you can retain in your mind. And so you're going to probably want to take notes if you're wanting to keep up with each of those scriptures. We live in very, very discouraging times. We all know this. For a Christian, everywhere we look, things seem to be going in the opposite direction of what we want it to. And if we're not careful, those things will begin to add up, and they'll begin to build up to the point that it'll result in you and I having a very heavy heart. And so that's what our text in Proverbs chapter 12, verse 25 speaks to, this heaviness of heart that we might experience. It says, "Heaviness in the heart of man maketh it stoop, but a good word maketh it glad." So what makes a heart heavy? Well, there could be any number of things. We understand that there are things that weigh us down, things like worry, disappointment, grief, perhaps sorrow, regret, feelings of betrayal, hurt, things of this nature. All of these can be instrumental in making us have hearts that are heavy. But based upon the second part of this verse, I think Solomon had discouragement in mind. He says, the heaviness in the heart of man maketh it stoop, but a good word maketh it glad, okay? So if a good word is the remedy for a heavy heart, it stands to reason that it might have been a bad word or discouraging words that caused the problem to start with. And so before we get to the positive side of things and talk about what is encouraging, let's discover together and discuss the things in our life that tend to discourage us. And if we identify those things, if we can put our finger on some of these things, then we can learn to avoid them as much as possible. And now, let's not be naive enough to think that we can avoid all sources of discouragement, because that's impossible. That'd be a very unrealistic hope for you and I. That life comes at us, okay, ready or not. Life is going to bring discouraging things that are unavoidable at times. But we can learn to take steps to minimize that discouragement, and also in identifying these sources of discouragement, we can also learn and make sure we're not the ones that are doing the discouraging of someone else, okay? Understand that. So let me first talk about our words. There's a reason that's going to be number one on our list this morning, because the most common source of discouragement is the words of others, okay? Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue." What someone says can either lift up or it can tear down. Our words can ruin someone's day or they can make someone's day. So we would all do well to ask ourselves before we speak, is what I'm about to say helpful, and is it necessary? Does it need to be said? Now, if it's even remotely, even has the potential for being a discouragement to people, does it have to be said, is the question. Sometimes, yes. Sometimes there are situations that it needs to be said in order to help that person see something. Sometimes we have to declare certain negative things to people that are close to us in order to help the situation and help them learn from it, okay? But even then, it can be done with an abundance of caution and prayerfully, carefully crafted words. In other words, we go in with not the desire to discourage, but the desire to avoid discouragement, and use words and a disposition that would help them see what we're wanting them to see, but not discourage them. I couldn't tell you over the course of all these years how many times I've had to talk to a person. Maybe it's a negative situation, maybe it's a problem, maybe it's a mishap, but I had to talk to that person, and I knew what I was going to have to talk to them about was negative. I knew it had the potential to create offense, okay? But I slowed down, I bathed it in prayer, And with the power of the Holy Spirit and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, I was able to soften my words, have a humble attitude, and deal with the person, and the whole thing turned out well. Okay? But before you say, attaboy, Brother Chris, there's also been times that I've gone into a situation half angry and irritated and used the words that came to my mind, and it turned out disastrous. You see? I didn't handle it in the right way. So the choice lies within us. And let me tell you, that negative approach that I just spoke of is a dual-edged sword. First of all, think about this for a moment. If we wade into a situation and we just say what's on our mind, we are being the source of discouragement for that person, okay? But what else has taken place, the other side of the sword, is this. We've brought discouragement into our own lives, whether we know it or not. Because why? We've done wrong. We've done the wrong thing. And deep down, whether we admit it or not, even if we're lying to ourselves, deep down, we know we've done wrong, so we begin to feel guilty. We have created potentially an enemy with the other person, so each time we see that person, or each time that person crosses our mind, it produces negative thoughts in our head, and what we've done is we produced our own discouragement. Never pays off, friends, to deal with situations in the flesh and in our own way. The Bible says, be in Ephesians 4:26, be angry and sin not. There are going to be things in our life that anger us, upset us, irritate us, but bringing that emotion of anger being upset into bringing it under control, not allowing it to come out in words or in attitudes that would do harm, then we're going to come out ahead, friends. But here's another step we need to take in order to have discouragement removed from our life or to avoid it as much as possible. We need to learn to steer clear of angry people. The Bible says in Proverbs 22 and verse 24, make no friendship with an angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go. You know, simply put, there are toxic people in this world. People who are not happy with anything. People that are mad at everything from the government to the car that's in front of them. They're just mad, it seems. And with that anger comes a bunch of negative rhetoric, toxic words, toxic attitudes, toxic opinions, and we must, friends, according to Scripture, as we just read, we've got to get away from people like that. We just have to distance ourselves and go from their presence, number one, because it's going to bring us down. Number two, it's going to rub off on us and begin to make us more cynical and more negative and upset about things. And that's not at all what we need. Proverbs 14:7 says, go from the presence of a foolish man when thou perceivest not in him the lips of knowledge. There again, God says, get away. Move away. And I've seen this, and you've seen this happen before, where maybe we've got a friend. I think of one particular instance with myself. A friend of mine was beginning to not be himself. He was normally a very positive, very jovial person and easy to be around, and all of a sudden he's becoming more negative and standoffish and somewhat cynical, and I'm thinking, what's going on? Well, the problem was is his routine had put him in close contact with another guy who was just a certified fool. I mean, a guy that was so negative, and he's never going to, no matter how few friends he had, he's never going to change his ways. He's never going to close his mouth. He's just always spewing poison. And so I prayed about it, and I cautioned my friend. I was close enough to him that I could. Well, it wasn't very long till the situation was corrected and there was a distance put between him and the fool, and it wasn't very long till he was back to himself. His old jovial, positive, encouraging self. Friends, are who we spend time with does affect us. When we talk to our children when we're little, and we tell them, you've got to stay away from trouble, but sometimes we adults need to learn that. Stay away from someone. The Bible says, he that walketh with wise men shall be wise, but a companion of fools shall be destroyed. Friends, there's just times. It's kind of tough, too. I understand that. Because sometimes the people that we need to distance are have been friends for a long time. I'm not saying sever the friendship, okay? I'm saying distancing ourselves. It may make that person not like us. But we cannot afford to not heed the Bible on this particular topic. If a person is bringing us down, now is the time to get away from them because it's not going to get better. How many of you know a cynical, negative person? Don't look. Don't look. Don't look beside you. Okay, yeah, but you know him, right? Yeah, says he's right next to me, okay? We know that people are like that. And here's the next question that's very hard. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. How many times have we been that person? The one that brought negative ideas, negative rhetoric to the environment or the situation? God forbid, because we as children, we're children of light. Our words should be words that are uplifting and encouraging. Not to say that we can't face the facts and discuss the facts, but the manner in which we discuss the facts is important. If we have been or are being that negative person, it's a time for confession and repentance. God doesn't want us to be that way. Matthew chapter 12 and verse 36, Jesus says, every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. God forbid that we as Christians be the ones that bring darkness to every conversation, okay? Without question, we're going to answer to God for those negative, discouraging words, and so we need to get it corrected. Here's another one. Sin. Sin brings discouragement to our life. Remember what our text said there in Proverbs 12 and 25? Heaviness in the heart of man maketh it stoop. A heavy heart is a burdened heart. Sin burdens our heart. Now, before we came to the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation, we carried the burden of all of our sins. None of our sins had been forgiven, so all of our sins weighed us down, okay? And that's a burden. Maybe perhaps there's somebody here this morning that is still under the burden of that all those sins, okay? Let me just tell you this. It's never going to go away until you meet Jesus. The burden, the heaviness that you're feeling over your sins will never go away until you meet Jesus. But when you meet Jesus, those sins are forgiven, which means the weight of them, the penalty of them has been taken away. You have no penalty attached to those sins anymore. And so the load has been taken off of you, okay? In which case, you're going to be set free in your heart, no longer stooping, as our text says, under the weight of it. That's your choice this morning, okay? But if you are that person, now we'll revisit this during the invitation, but you need to make a choice today for Jesus, okay? Understand that. But for those of us who are already saved, those of us who are already forgiven of our sins and have eternal security, that doesn't mean that sin no longer has any weight to it. It doesn't have any condemning weight. We're not going to go to hell for it. But it has convicting weight. When you and I as God's children are doing things that are wrong, and we know they're wrong, that inviting that sin into our life and tolerating it, maybe even indulging that sin, that will become a heavy burden for us, okay? We begin to experience the guilt and shame in some cases of having done those things. Deep down, we know we're wrong, whether we admit it or not. And it's the knowledge of that we've done wrong that nags at us and makes our heart heavy. Furthermore, beyond the heavy heart, the consequences of doing those things can bring discouragement. You know, the Bible says in Galatians 6 and verse 7, it says, be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. You know what it's saying? It's talking about planting seeds. Whatever seed you plant, then that's what the fruit you're going to get of it. So whatever a man soweth, that shall he reap. If he soweth to the flesh, he shall reap of the flesh corruption. If he soweth to the Spirit, he shall reap of the Spirit everlasting life. Okay? Think about that. We cannot sow the wrong seed and expect to get a good fruit crop or a good crop. We can't sow the wind and be shocked when we reap the whirlwind. Okay? We understand that. And so many times we've seen it and done it. A backslider sit back and scratch their head and say, I wonder why all this is happening to me. Everything seems to be falling apart. What do we expect? Galatians 6:7 says, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. That is an undeniable law, a spiritual law. It's like the law of gravity. That spiritual law is not going to be violated any more than the physical law of gravity is going to be violated. Sunday, this last week, the word's already out, so I'll go ahead and spill the beans. And I'm a cowboy. I don't like to admit it, but I got bucked off last Sunday after church, Sunday night, and got bucked off hard, okay? Well, me and that horse, we went up together. We came down separate, okay? And gravity set in, right? And I couldn't defy gravity, so I hit the ground, and I hit it very hard. Now, can you imagine how far I'd have fell if that ground hadn't been there? Okay? I mean, wow. Okay? Gravity can't be defied anymore, the law of sowing and reaping can't be defied any more than the law of gravity can. So, what we do, our sins, our misbehavior, violating God's word and knowing that we're violating God's word is going to bring discouragement into our life. Here's another verse, Proverbs chapter 14. The first part of the verse says, the backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways. In other words, what it's saying is, if we are backslidden, when our behaviors and our actions and our decisions are made, they will catch up to us. We'll be filled with our own ways. Let me illustrate this in the simplest, most understandable terms that I can. We all understand money. Money speaks a universal language. So, here it is. If we have uncontrolled, impulsive spending, there's going to be a very short-lived joy that comes with that initial purpose, a purchase, right, of whatever it is. But then what comes is difficulty and discouragement when the bills start coming in, when the creditors start calling. You see, sin works very much the same way. It may have a little bit of satisfaction initially, but those satisfying feelings are very short-lived, and then suddenly it bites us really hard, and that's when the discouragement comes in. On the other hand, I want you to look at the second half of Proverbs 14:14. It says, a good man shall be satisfied from himself. A good man shall be satisfied from himself. Now, I like that because I want to be a good man. Okay, I'm not always, but I want to be a good man. I know you want to be a good man, good woman, good young person, whatever. A good man can be encouraged, can be satisfied, according to this verse, can be pleased, not in an arrogant, prideful way, but just pleased with the life they're living because they're living for God. A good man lives for God, okay? And so there's not reason to fret. So even when the whole world around us is going to pieces, it's going to be all right. When we turn on the TV and we see the news, and or if we get up in the morning and we read the headlines and things are in a mess. Things are in a mess in Afghanistan. Things are in a mess down at the border. Things are in a mess in Washington. We see the inflation, the economic mess. We see all of these things, and it's discouraging if we let it. But then also, we can recognize, hey, I'm just doing what I'm supposed to be doing, serving God, being that good person, if you will, not in our own strength, by the way. So I don't have to be discouraged. God is on the throne. He is in control. So my job is to make sure that I'm doing things His way, being good, as the verse speaks of. And then I can take heart and be encouraged regardless of what's happening around me. Folks, righteousness is a very soft pillow. Thinking right, doing right, and being right, makes for very good sleep. There's no way around it. We can't do anything about, I mean, we can make an impact on our surroundings, yes, but we can't change the world. And we sure can't change what we see happen, in other areas of the world, okay, and this sort of thing, or on TV. But what we can do is make sure that our life, as best we can, with the strength of the Lord, is lining up with God's word. And then, friends, you can be encouraged. I'll leave you with this last thought. Positive news brings encouragement to us. Proverbs 15 and verse 30, the second part of the verse says, "A good report maketh the bones fat." Now, that's old time terminology there, to make the bones fat. In other words, just prospers us and makes things good. A good report makes us happy. It pleases us. Proverbs 25:25 says, "As cold waters to a thirsty soul, so is good news from a far country." Friends, positive news brings encouragement to us. A good report, it speaks of, and good news, it speaks of. It sounds pretty nice, right? I like a good report. I like good news. Who's not encouraged when the kids come home with straight A's on the report card? That's a good report. Who's not pleased at when you get the doctor's report after your yearly examination? You got a good report. Who's not pleased with a good report? Who's not pleased when you hear good news of some kind? Maybe you find that your tax return is going to be greater than you expected. That's good news. Maybe you learn that your in-laws are moving away. It's good news. You know what the word gospel means? Good news. The death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is good news. And Jesus has taken care of everything that we need taken care of over the long haul. Life might deal us a few blows, might knock us around, bruise us up, and beat us up along the way. But for the long haul, Jesus has taken care of everything that needs to be taken care of. Things are looking good for eternity, folks. And what a great report we have in this book. What God reports to you and I is truly a good report. It's good news. So what better way to defend ourselves against the discouragement of life than to have a steady diet of this? Reminding ourselves of who's in control. And it's in this book that we discover the truth of the matter. Regardless of what the world's screaming at us, we see the truth of the matter, and it's that truth, as Jesus says, that shall set us free. Folks, I want to tell you, I know I've harped on this a lot, but the media's not going to do anything to bring us up, okay? It'll bring you down, but this book will bring you up every time. I've always said, people take in as much TV as they choose to, that's fine, and we even do as well, but if we would exchange just 30 minutes or 15 of our media time for Proverbs and Psalms or the book of John or whatever it might be, our whole perspective would change. Our heart would be lifted, and it wouldn't be stooping, if you will, under the heaviness that this world has put upon it. I'm going to ask you to stand, if you will. And I'm going to invite any and everybody who might feel led by God to come to this altar and to pray, whatever the case may be. But I want to revisit what I talked about earlier. I want to revisit what I talked about earlier about whether you know the Lord Jesus Christ or not. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ and you're under the burden of those sins, that weight can be lifted in just a few moments. Just a few moments. You can come down here and I can share with you what it means to pray and ask the Lord into your heart, and those sins are forgiven and taken off, and there's no heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If God's spoken to you for any reason, you come. I'll be standing right up here with my Bible if you need me. I wanted to introduce to you, most of you already know Jennifer, but some of you don't know Kevin. This is Kevin Cross. Y'all come step up here and Jeff will stand with you. And this is Jennifer Calvin and Kevin Cross. The two of them, Jennifer's been coming for quite some time. Both her boys were saved and baptized here in our church. But she wants to join. Her membership has been at Victory Life there in Lubbock. And so she would be coming by letter. So I will, I'll entertain a motion to accept that membership. Brother Jeff's got a motion. A second back here in the back. Jerry, all in favor say amen. All right. Any opposition? Raise your hand. No, I didn't think so. Okay, and we have Kevin coming, and Kevin comes by statement of faith. He's been saved. He's been scripturally baptized, and he wants to join our church as well. And so I'll entertain that motion, okay? Brother Dwayne's got that in a second. All right, Brother Royce, all in favor say amen. 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 Any opposition? Nowhere. Okay. Jeff, will you take them to the back, and I'll be back here in just a minute, guys, and stand with y'all. Get by there and give them the right hand of fellowship, hug their neck, love on them a little bit, let them know that you're glad they're part of Bible Baptist. Guys, you're doing good. You're keeping your church strong. What a good group this is today, I tell you. And we're going to keep it up. We're going to get these kids. We're working hard, folks. COVID's put a whole different mentality for some reason over kids. We're having a terrible time getting this group filled back up. But we're going to keep working hard. Had a great event yesterday, Cooper and Matt and Lauren and all of them. We went to the corn maze, took a total of 61 to the corn maze of our young people. And so we're doing what we can, but it's hard to get them here Sunday morning. If you're a parent or a grandparent of one of these kids, take charge and say, you're going, okay? You're going to the house of God, okay? All right, appreciate you guys so much. And we will go ahead and be dismissed in a word of prayer. And Brother Dwayne, will you lead us, please?